First, let me say good morning to you all and a very warm welcome to those who are able to be with us here this morning, but a very special welcome to everybody who's watching on their video or television screens this morning. It's sad that we cannot be together, but we are very much together in spirit. So let's just have a moment of silence as we gather our thoughts together, as we prepare to worship God in the very best way we can. And so we say together, Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We truly believe in a forgiving God, and so when we come into worship, we want to begin again knowing that we can, when we turn to God with an open heart, to let go of those sins that have bound us, that we may be free to love one another and to serve God in the way we are called to do. So let us reflect for a moment and draw to mind those sins which alienate us from God and from one another. And so we confess our sins. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved thee with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In thy mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to mend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with thee, our God. Amen.
Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And so we pray the prayer for this Sunday. Almighty God, whose Son revealed in signs and miracles the wonder of thy everlasting salvation, renew thy people with thy heavenly grace, and in all our weakness, sustain us by thy mighty power, through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
So we now have our Old Testament and lesson from the Epistle, from the New Testament.
A reading from the book of Genesis. After Abram returned from defeating Kedemlah and the kings allied with him, the king of Sodom came out to meet him in the valley of Shaveh, that is the king's valley. Then Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. He was priest of the God Most High, and he blessed Abram, saying, "Blessed be Abram by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth, and praise be to God Most High, who delivered your enemies into your hand." Then Abram gave him the tenth of everything. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the Revelation to St. John the Divine. Then I heard what sounded like a great multitude, like a roar of the rushing waters, like the loud peals of thunder, shouting, "Alleluia, for our God Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory, for the wedding of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. Fine linen, bright and clean, was given for her to wear. Fine linen stands for the righteous acts of God's holy people. Then the angel said to me, write this. Blessed are those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb. And he added, these are the true words of God. At this, I fell at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, do not do that. I am a fellow servant with you and with your brothers and sisters who hold to the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for it is the spirit of prophecy who bears testimony to Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. And now we're going to have some lovely music from the hymn, God is Love, Let Heaven Adore Him. Jesus Christ, according to St. John. Glory to you.
Me, O Lord.
On the third day, there was a wedding at Cana in Galilee. The mother of Jesus was there, and Jesus and his disciples were guests also. The wine gave out. So Jesus' mother said to him, they have no wine left. He answered, Your concern, mother, is not mine. My hour has not yet come. His mother said to the servants, Do whatever he tells you. There were 6 stone water jars standing there, of the kind used for Jewish rites of purification. Each held from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, Fill the jars with water. And they filled them to the brim. Now, draw some off, he ordered, and take it to the steward of the feast. And they did so. The steward tasted the water, now turned into wine, not knowing its source. Though the servants who had drawn the water knew, he hailed the bridegroom and said, Everyone serves the best wine first and waits until the guests have drunk freely before serving the poorer sort. But you have kept the best wine till now. This deed at Cana in Galilee is the first of the signs by which Jesus revealed his glory and led his disciples to believe in him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. One of the lovely things about the lectionary in the Church of England is that you have a choice of whether you have a consecutive reading or whether you have a related reading. And I chose, actually, the related reading this morning, but when I looked at the readings, I thought, how on earth do I figure a connection between Genesis and Abraham and this extraordinary marriage at Cana? And when I thought about it and put my mind really to both readings and indeed the Revelation passage, which helps us enormously, I realised there's a very strong connection. So let's start first of all with the one we know very well, the wedding at Cana in Galilee. It was indeed just after the account of Philip bringing Nathanael to Jesus and making up the team of disciples. So it was almost as though he was now ready to begin his ministry. And so Jesus does this extraordinary miracle, a sign. But what is the point of it? What is he trying to say to you and to me and indeed the disciples when he began? And I think there are quite a few reasons. First of all, you know, he probably didn't want the poor father who provided the wine to run out. He wanted a good party. And I will never forget going to see the life of Christ at Wintershall when they reenacted this marvellous moment of the wedding. And there was Jesus, the actor, dressed the part, drinking and merrymaking, dancing with the people. And for me, it was just a very ordinary, happy occasion where family and friends celebrated the love that two people have for each other. And he therefore probably wanted that to go on. But secondly, he was actually trying to say something. And that was simply that he cared about the people. He valued them and he wanted them to have all that he could give. But the marvellous thing is in that story, and I think there's a little humour here, because when the steward turns out with the wine, he said, normally I go to a wedding and they serve up the good wine first, and then whenever I'm suitably drunk, they serve up the plonk. But you have kept the best wine until last. And there's a strong message in that, because I think so often in our impatient world, we want everything now, and we can't wait, whether that's in marriage or whether it's also in ministry. It takes time. And Jesus was going to take his time in bringing the very message of God to the people. But I think the really important thing which underlies the whole of the gospel message, is that Jesus cares. He cares passionately about the people, he cares passionately about his disciples, and he cares passionately about the world. And so the whole of this sign, this first miracle that he wrought, is about his care for the world. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And here is the strong message. But what is that to do with Genesis? And I find that a fascinating one, because if you just read a little bit more of the material before the passage that Nigel read for us, it was a time when there were so many battles and intrigues and associations, coalitions, whatever you want, between rather minor kings at that time in the land where Abraham had settled. And they fought one another. And sadly, Abraham's nephew Lot was part of the collateral damage, and he was captured with his family, with all his goods and animals, and taken off into slavery. And when Abraham heard about this, he was clearly indignant and probably angry, and he set about restoring Lot to his rightful place. And so he gathered together a mere 318 of his men, and they went in the darkness of night and attacked these people and rescued Lot. And for me, it is again about Abraham showing great care. Because as God cared for Abraham, and Abraham honored God by obedience to his will to go to a foreign land, Abraham cares for his nephew Lot, and was going to bring him back home. And so we see two connecting stories about how caring for one another is vitally important. And then when we get to the end and read again the Revelation passage, we have perhaps an indication of what Jesus is aiming at. When he goes to that wedding, it's a prophecy of that divine wedding, that banquet in heaven, the supper of the Lamb, where people will be invited to come. You may well remember that wonderful parable that Jesus told in Matthew 22, when the king sent his servant out to gather together all the people to celebrate the king's son's wedding. And they slowly refused to accept it and to turn up. And he said, right, go out of the world, into the highways and the byways, and bring everybody in to celebrate, because those invited will not be able to come. And in this wedding in Revelation, St. John sees this wonderful image of God bringing together the people whom he truly loves, the faithful ones who are obedient to his word and to his will. And of course, the bride is dressing up in the fine linen, shining bright, a wonderful image of the bride at a wedding. And who is the bride but you and me? Because we are the church, the bride of Christ. And it is that wonderful moment when Jesus simply reminds us all that, like the groom at a wedding, he gives his all to the bride, this self-sacrifice. And going back then to that wedding at Cana in Galilee, there was the water, those six jars containing 20 or 30 gallons apiece. What a wedding party that was going to be. He turns it into wine, and the very best kind of wine. And he's simply reminding us that the water is the water of baptism, but it is the water of repentance, when we cleanse ourselves before God and humbly seek to serve him. And the wine becomes our Lord's sacrifice, his self-offering, his self-giving, and it is the very best self-offering as he gave his life on that cross for you and for me. And so we go from the beginning of his journey of baptism to the cross, and all the time, the message is simply there. God cares for you and for me. And here we are at this awful time of this COVID-19, and what I praise God for is the amount of great care that people have shown to other people, very often strangers. And that is what keeps us going. That's what upholds the world, the goodness and the trust that we have in one another, but above all, that trust and love that comes from God himself. And so let's take to heart, as we continue this journey, to care for one another at a very deep level, but remember that that care comes from God. Amen.
Amen.
So let's now all stand and all together affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Amen.
So let us sit or kneel for our prayers. And the response, Lord, in your mercy, is simply hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, as we gather together to celebrate these holy mysteries, reminding ourselves of the sacrifice and the love of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray that we may respond and care for one another in a deep and truly caring way. For we are all your children, called to serve you in this world and to bring life and hope to others. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father Almighty, at this difficult time we pray for all who are concerned with the welfare of others. We pray for our National Health Service, for all our doctors and nurses and agencies of healing, for our nursing homes, and people who are looking after the weak and vulnerable. We pray that they may be given strength in times of great stress and strain. And we pray too for those in government at a very difficult time. We pray for guidance, for wisdom, for shared knowledge that brings help and relief to many. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our community in which we live. We pray especially for our families and friends, wherever they may be, for our neighbours, that we may continually reach out to friend and stranger alike, to bring support, encouragement, and hope. We give thanks for those contacts made and a voice at the end of a phone. We thank you, O Lord, for the care that people share. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who suffer. Those who suffer loneliness and despair, that they may find their strength in you, the God of love who cares. We pray for those in our hospitals. We pray especially for all who mourn. And we pray that we may truly surround each other with the prayers of love, bringing hope and healing to all in need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We commend into your mercy, O Lord, those who have died, those who have passed from our sight, but not from our memories. We give you thanks for all whom we have known and loved, and especially those who have helped us on our own journey. May we be united in faith and truly know that we are never separated from those we love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
And so let's bring all our prayers together as we share the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. As we prepare the altar, we will now have our next hymn. To suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel, command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread, when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this. For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me." Amen.
Amen.
So draw near with faith and receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. First, a prayer for this Sunday. Almighty God, whose Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, is the light of the world, grant that thy people, illumined by thy word and sacraments, may shine with the radiance of his glory, that he may be known, worshipped, and obeyed to the ends of the earth, who liveth and reigneth now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
And we say together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory.
Amen.
So before the blessing, we listen and hear the words of "Hail to the Lord's Anointed."
Thank you.
Christ, the Son of God, perfect in you the image of his glory, and gladden your hearts with the good news of his kingdom. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.
So go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ, we will.